Hey everyone, welcome to Catholicism Wow. So is it wrong to allow and even cultivate a belief in Santa Claus in your children? Pastor Mike Winger has some very interesting views on this topic. And this is going to be somewhat of a unique rebuttal video because I don't necessarily agree with Pastor Mike's opinion on this subject. Or I don't necessarily disagree with Pastor Mike's opinion on this subject. However, I do think he's extremely misguided in why he holds the opinion that he holds. And I do think that he has some very faulty reasons for holding the opinion and for taking the position that he takes. I don't think that his reasons are really based in good logic. And also, I think he leaves out a lot of facts, especially the facts of where the commercialized image of Santa Claus comes from. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So let's get into Pastor Mike's video and see what he has to say on the subject. Once again, this is going to be an excerpt from a longer 20 questions with Pastor Mike video, but we're just going to focus on this one segment.
Said, what do you tell your kids about Santa? Oh, a strangely volatile question. Is there a chance that kids who find out Santa isn't real might think the same about Jesus? Will you spoil Santa for children that aren't yours?
All right, first of all, never, ever spoil a belief in Santa Claus for somebody else's children. You're not their parent. That's not their place. And it's not very Christ-like if you want to know my true opinion. I don't believe that Jesus would take it upon himself to parent somebody else's child. In fact, we see in scripture that Jesus praises children for having a childlike faith. And he encourages adults to be more childlike in certain situations where it's allowed, where it's called for, where it's appropriate. So, yeah, it's not your place to spoil Santa Claus for somebody else's children. If, after watching this video, you still believe strongly that cultivating a belief in Santa Claus is inappropriate, then the right thing to do is to go to the parents and try to convince them of your position. But under no circumstances should you ever spoil Santa Claus for somebody else's children. That is not your place.
All right, let me separate the Santa issue into a few topics. One, it'll ruin your faith. Or will it ruin your faith, right? That topic, that's a separate question. Then there's a separate issue that I'm more on board with, which is that is not true. This is moving towards the realm of bold-faced deception for the sake of your own entertainment, but it's deception. It's not play, which is different. Kids know play. Play's fun. Play's good. Play, I'm going to be a monster attacking you. But you're not actually convincing your kid you're really a monster attacking them. Right? That's play. This is just bold-faced deception, in my opinion.
It is play, though. It's pretend. It's make-believe. And it's fun. And it's a part of the childhood experience. Now, people who know me personally and are watching this video are probably screaming hypocrite at their television sets right now. And trust me, I have my own beliefs and I have my own opinions on the subject, and we will get to those when it's appropriate to the video. However, I do not believe that my opinions are necessarily the right ones. They're just mine. And I will do whatever I can to convince you of my position. But at the end of the day, what you choose to do with your children is up to you. And I'm not going to tell you, like Pastor Mike will, that your parenting decisions are wrong or incorrect or evil. I mean, he's, at least to me, Pastor Mike, if you're watching this video and I'm mischaracterizing your position, then by all means, please let me know. However, to me, it seems like when he calls cultivating a belief in Santa Claus bold-faced deception, to me, it sounds like he's calling it evil. And that's just, in my opinion, extremely wrong-headed. It's not evil at all. It's a parenting choice. And many people have many parenting choices that are neither good nor evil. I think cultivating a belief in Santa Claus is a very neutral parenting decision.
And then maybe a third category we could say, which is a category of replacement. Okay, let me come back to that one. How is Santa replacement, that issue? So first off, does Santa cause people to lose their faith? Sometimes it does cause the unbreaking of a dam where, and I know there's testimonies. I've actually asked on Twitter, a long time ago. I just asked whoever followed me there. But those of you who were taught that there was a Santa Claus, that he was real and all that, when you found out there wasn't, how did that affect you? I was just curious. And I'd seen a variety of responses. Some people said this was like totally made me question everything about God, because somehow the concept of Santa and their belief in that felt similar when they stopped believing that to their belief in God. Now, it's not for me, okay? And it shouldn't be, because your reasons for believing in Santa versus your reasons for believing in God are radically different. And anybody who goes, if you still believe in God, you may as well believe in Santa, like, this is a very shallow faith. It's a faith that's not, it's responsive merely to I believe in God because, you know, people around me say so. Instead of like, I look around and I perceive that God's been revealed through creation. I look at fulfilled prophecy, or I consider the resurrection of Jesus, or I see the work of God in my own life. Like, Santa ain't got nothing like that on me. So that's strange, but it does happen in some cases. I don't think it's the majority. I don't think it's common.
I agree. And if your belief in God as a child, if you grew up believing in God as a child and then, you know, stopped believing in God as a teenager or a young adult, and, you know, the only reason why you feel like you ever believed in God in the first place was just because the adults in your life told you, I'm going to say right now that the adults in your life failed you. They failed to cultivate an understanding of God within you. And so if God is literally just a fairy tale in your home, then of course you're going to grow up thinking that God is just a fairy tale. And this is why cultivating a belief in Santa Claus isn't all that bad, because when we cultivate a belief in Santa Claus, even if it's a genuine belief, it's still, on some level, our children still know that it's a fairy tale. It's just a fairy tale they want to be true. It's a fairy tale they want to believe in. And most children that I know of aren't crushed when they find out that Santa Claus isn't real. Most of them are coming to that realization on their own. And that's usually when parents elect to spoil the Santa Claus illusion for their children, is when the children are already coming to that realization on their own. But you don't come really to the realization that there's no God on your own unless that God image that you were engendered with as a child was engendered in you as nothing more than a fairy tale to begin with. So, yeah, I agree with Pastor Mike here. Like, if learning there's no Santa Claus makes you doubt God, then you have a very weak faith to begin with. And that's not your fault. That's your parents and your grandparents and your aunts and your uncles and all the adults in your life. That's their fault. That's their fault for not cultivating within you an understanding of God that's deeper than just a fairy tale.
Think of it like a medication someone takes, and they go, in rare cases, there's this side effect. I think that there, in rare cases, there's the side effect of people abandoning their faith, at least appearance-wise, saying, I don't know about this whole God thing. That's a concern, okay? Even a rare side effect is still a side effect. Okay, so that is a concern, but I would not want to project that onto everybody. I think most people who believe in Santa as a kid, it has no impact on their beliefs about God and religion, and it shouldn't. It shouldn't. Plenty of us had believed things that were not true that our parents told us, maybe because they thought it was true. this, why would this affect my belief in God? It shouldn't. But in some cases it does.
And the solution to that is not cultivating a belief in Santa Claus necessarily. It's cultivating a proper belief in God. Church should not be for your children just a place that we go because we just do, or because we have to, because it's a responsibility or an obligation. You should be teaching your children why we go. You should be teaching your children what the Mass is about, and you should be engendering in your children a proper understanding that Christ is truly present in the room, and that we are in his presence, that we are in the presence of God and in the presence of the Lord, and that they should also behave reverently. We should also be cultivating in our children the proper way to behave at church, you know, when they're age appropriate. Obviously, toddlers are going to be toddlers. They don't quite have the understanding yet. But, you know, once your child gets to you 5 or 6, they should be, they should know why it's proper to behave properly at church.
Okay, the second issue is that of it's just a deception. Telling your kids, we're going to pretend there's a Santa Claus, that would be one thing, but deceiving them, I know it's common, okay? And every argument against the deception thing, well, let me put it this way, a lot of the arguments against me here, like I said, it's volatile, would be, that's not a problem. And you're really thinking, it's not a problem because we always do that. And we've always done that. And for generations, we've done that. So how could it be a problem? You're basically insulting my grandma by saying this, Mike. And I'll be like, well, your grandma's not as perfect as you think anyways, but more to the point, we have always done this is not an argument against it being deceptive, and deceptive in a significant way. If I were to tell kids, we're going to pretend there's a jolly fat dude who's going to bring you presents, and he flies in a reindeer and all this stuff, and they want to partake in a game, that would be, you could have the fun of it, but without the deception. But parents get a delight when their kids really believe that noise on the roof is Santa Claus, and they laugh at their kids and they get a delight out of it. And part of it is them feeling like maybe they could recapture their own sort of youth when they were dumb enough to believe such things. I think that this whole thing is mixed with a level of deception that is unhealthy and that is not appropriate. Is it the worst thing in the world? No. Does it mean they're a bad parent? No, I didn't say that. I think this was a bad act, in my opinion. But it's a bad act that's layered with so much sugar and spice and everything nice and presents and jolly Saint Nick. It's layered with so much sort of surface level goodness that it feels like it's fine. But at the core, it's a very deceptive thing.
So this is where I agree with Pastor Mike's opinion, but I don't really agree with why or how he arrives at that opinion. I don't think that cultivating a belief in Santa Claus with your children is some sort of grave deception. Is it a deception? Yes, but it's a harmless deception. It's like when your wife asks you, do these pants make my butt look big? And you tell her no. Or when she says, am I gaining weight? And you tell her, you're just as beautiful to me today as the day we met. To you, that might be true, but objectively, it's not. And a lot of men, even if they don't believe it, will still say it because that's what you say to save your wife's feelings. It's the same thing with if you know that a beloved family member is dying, you might not tell your children that grandpa's not going to be with us very much longer. You just let them enjoy the time that they have with grandpa while they have it. And again, that's a deception, but it's one for the greater good. Now, I don't think that cultivating a belief in Santa Claus is necessarily for the greater good, but I also don't believe that it's for a greater evil. And I think it was wrongheaded for Pastor Mike to characterize parents who do this, which is the vast majority of parents, by the way, as getting some kind of sick pleasure from watching their children believe in Santa Claus. It's not about that. It's about having fun and having traditions and, you know, and cultivating happy memories with your children. Now, this is where my objective opinion and my personal opinion diverge. My children did not grow up believing in Santa Claus. I did not choose to cultivate that belief in my children because I don't want to lie to my kids. I want my kids to know that if dad tells them something, it's true. It's real. It's they can count on it. And so I never cultivated. And as a child, I never had a sincere belief in Santa Claus. My earliest memories were of playing along because it seemed to make the adults happy. It seemed to make the grownups happy. So I just went along with it because it made them happy. And so that was how I instilled it in my children. I explained to my children, the true stories of St. Nicholas. You know, I explained to them where the legend of Santa Claus came from and the Catholic and Christian roots of it. And I explained to them that Santa Claus is a fantasy, is a fairy tale that we use to celebrate a great Christian man. And we still, you know, my kids grew up knowing that Santa Claus is like Superman. He's a nice idea. He just isn't real, but he's still super fun. And so, you know, when my kids were younger, every year we would go to the Santa tracker and we'd follow him all around the world. And we'd be like, oh, he's getting closer. He's getting closer. You got to go to bed now. You got to go to bed now. And my kids knew that it was all make-believe and it was all fun and it was play and it was games. And we were able to have that fun and that enjoyment and those memories without having to lie to my children. Like deep down, they knew that it was make-believe, but they had fun playing make-believe. And my personal opinion is that that's the proper way to handle it. So on that level, I absolutely agree with Pastor Mike. It's definitely something to do for fun. But I don't think that parents that do cultivate this belief are doing a harm to their children. I think if anything, at worst, it's neutral. And at best, you are helping your children to develop a good imagination, which is a good. That is a net good. You are cultivating in your children the ability to believe in things that aren't necessarily real, because we all do that. We all do that. When you sit down and you read a book, if the novel is really good, you get lost in the world, you get lost in the characters, and while you're reading it, it's real. And if your children don't have this ability, they're not going to be able to enjoy reading books on a level that's healthy for them. And I'm not saying you have to lie to your children to do this. I cultivated in my children the same sense of imagination and the same sense of getting lost in a world that your intellectual mind knows is not real, but your imagination can just run with. And I did that without deceiving them. But at the same time, if you choose to allow your children to just believe, that's okay too. I don't think you're doing them a harm. I don't think you're damaging your children. And you should be giving them a concept of God that is completely different than the concept that you're giving them of Santa Claus. Because at the end of the day, Santa Claus is a fairy tale and God's not.
Okay, so the third thing is replacement. Santa and this is something I feel as strongly about, Santa replaces Jesus as the center of the holiday. This is not every case, certainly not in every case. In purposeful families who are intent about the resurrection, the death, the life, the incarnation of Christ, and they care about these things, and they want to instill these truths in their kids, and they're true, they're not deceptions. They can do this, and they maybe even have a layer of a Santa thing going on, and they hope that the two don't get muddied together and all this. But for the most part, in most homes, Santa has replaced the emphasis on Jesus. Jesus is a footnote. Santa is the you know, he's the headline. He's the star of the show.
Well, now we've come to the portion of the video that's going to be absolutely heartbreaking for Protestants who think that the commercialization of Christmas and the idea of Santa Claus replacing Jesus as the star of the show, as Pastor Mike puts it, this part of the video is going to be really heartbreaking for you, because I hate to tell you, but that's your fault. So, in Germany, Santa Claus, or the character that evolved into the American version of Santa Claus, looks like this. Even still today, he's depicted as a bishop, as St. Nicholas was. St. Nicholas was the Bishop of Myra. He was present at the Council of Nicaea. There is a story, a legend, whatever you want to call it, of St. Nicholas slapping. He didn't punch him. A lot of people think that he closed pit fist punched him, but it was more of like a bitch slap. There is a story that that St. Nicholas slapped the heretic Arius at the Council of Nicaea, and that he was temporarily reprimanded for that because it was deemed to be behavior unbecoming a bishop of the church. Now, that story may very possibly be apocryphal. That might be just a legend that never really happened. However, I have never wanted a story to be more true in my entire life. But St. Nicholas, the character or the person who the Santa Claus legends are very firmly based on, was a Catholic bishop. And at the time, this was the 300s. There was only the Catholic Church. So he was a Christian bishop. And in the 1860s, a man named Thomas Nast, who was a he was German. He was born in Germany. He was raised as a Catholic, but in his 20s, he became infatuated with and eventually married a Protestant woman. This was, his parents had moved to the United States when he was a small child, and he converted to Protestantism. And not only did he convert to Protestantism, but he became very anti-Catholic. He drew some absolutely disgusting anti-Catholic cartoons that depict the church as, you know, as trying to devour little children. And there's a cartoon where he depicts Catholic bishops as crocodiles and the church as a wolf trying to devour children in the public school system. He drew some very disgusting, very bigoted, very anti-Catholic cartoons. And he was hired to illustrate the poem, "Twas the Night Before Christmas." And when he did that, he reimagined Santa Claus. He used the British pagan legend of Father Christmas and mixed that with the German legends around Santa Claus, who again, still to this day, is depicted very much as a Catholic bishop. And he melded the two into the image of Santa Claus that we have here in America today. And he removed all the Catholic elements, all the Christian elements. He secularized that character because he didn't want it to be associated with the Catholic Church, of which he absolutely had animosity towards. So if you are upset at the secularization of Christmas and the character of Santa Claus, you need to look in the mirror, because that was absolutely your fault. That was the Protestants' fault. Protestants in around the Civil War, and Thomas Nast was a great cartoonist when he wasn't demonizing and going after the Catholic Church. He created the character of Uncle Sam. Obviously he created the character of Santa Claus, at least his visual depiction. He created the idea that Santa Claus lives at the North Pole. Like, everything that is the modern Santa Claus came out of Thomas Nast's work. And that work was rooted in removing all of the Christian elements from the St. Nicholas character, because they were too Catholic for his taste. So, and this paved the way. This paved the way for the vast commercialization of Christmas and the secularization of Christmas and the replacing of Jesus with Santa Claus. So if you're mad that that's a thing, be mad at the right person. Be mad at the anti-Catholic movement in the United States, which is absolutely at fault for that. For Catholics, Christmas is still very much centered around the nativity, the birth of Christ, the liturgical meaning of the holiday. And so we never lost that. Protestants have lost that because Protestants have, since the Civil War, they've been slowly removing all of the Catholic elements, and that has paved the way for atheists and New Agers to secularize the holiday. So again, if you're going to be mad at somebody, be mad at the right person. Be mad at Thomas Nast, who really only did it to demonize the Catholic Church.
That's obviously wrong and bad, right? Because Christmas, if it means anything, it's a celebration of Jesus, his incarnation, God saving the world through his son, sending his son because he loves us so much. This is a great opportunity to preach the truth of Christ, to center people on eternal and important things. But instead, what we have is Miracle on 34th Street and these heartwarming, surface level good things that are a replacement for what we truly need, which is Jesus. Right? We need Jesus. We know, not just as a cutesy baby, but as the incarnate God of all creation coming into the weakness of humankind to bear our sin, to live perfectly, that we might have salvation from death that is chasing us down every day until it finally catches us in our lives. It couldn't be more important, and distracting us from that with Santa Claus seems like a big mistake, in my opinion.
For the past 50 years or so, I've been getting more and more worried about Christmas. Seems we're all so busy trying to beat the other fellow in making things go faster and look shinier and cost less that Christmas and I are sort of getting lost in the shuffle.
Oh, I don't think so. Christmas is still Christmas.
Oh, Christmas isn't just a day. It's a frame of mind. And that's what's been changing.
I absolutely agree that making Santa Claus a replacement for Christ on Christmas is absolutely a mistake. However, the existence of Santa Claus does not necessarily require the replacement of Christ. You can have both. And a responsible Christian parent would make sure that their child does have both. Because Santa Claus isn't just a silly guy, a jolly guy in a red suit that brings presents. As the clip from Miracle on 34th Street, the movie that you invoked yourself, demonstrates, when done properly, Santa Claus is the personification of the spirit of Christmas. Santa Claus lets us know that there is more to Christmas than just presents and dinners and Christmas movies. There's something more deeper under the surface. And it's up to us as Christian parents to explain to our children what that deeper meaning is. And Santa Claus does not have to be mutually exclusive to that. There's a wonderful image of Santa Claus kneeling at the manger and giving worship to the baby Jesus. That is the personification of Christmas. That is an image that absolutely defines what Christmas is. There's nothing wrong with Santa Claus. There's nothing wrong with having Santa Claus. There's nothing wrong with believing in Santa Claus. There's nothing wrong with incorporating Santa Claus into your Christmas traditions. Just make sure that he kneels before the king.
And here, like I said, there's probably rare cases or uncommon cases where the whole Santa deception causes people to disbelieve or doubt their faith in Christianity and God. And it shouldn't. But then it's probably reversed. Probably in most cases, a focus on Santa equals devaluing, de-emphasis, and a lowering importance, or even completely replacing Jesus as the center of the concept of Christmas is seeking to focus on the incarnation. There's my answers on that. I think our culture is wrong here, big time wrong, and obviously commercially, you're not going to sell as much stuff if you focus on Jesus, but if you focus on Santa, you can. So money is driving it to get even bigger. There you go.
While I 100% that Mike Winger would say amen to this, it isn't just important to keep Jesus at the center of our Christmas celebrations. It's important to keep him at the center of our entire everyday lives. And in a way, that's what the movie Miracle on 34th Street is trying to get across. Christmas is not just a day. Christmas is a state of mind. We must always remember not just that Jesus died, but that he was born. He was a man. He was one of us. He was 100% human, every bit as much as he was 100% divine. And that's what the Christmas story is about. It's not just celebrating the birth of the Savior. It's a reminder that he was once a vulnerable infant, just like all of us were. He needed his mother's breast to nurse, to live, to feed on. He needed to be loved. He needed to be cared for. He needed to be taught. The Bible doesn't say that Jesus was all-knowing from birth. The Bible doesn't say that. In fact, the Bible says the opposite. We know that there are things that Jesus in his human person wasn't privy to. There is knowledge that he wasn't privy to. Because he tells us that only the Father knows the day and the hour of the Son's return, that even the Son doesn't know. Jesus had to be nurtured. He had to be taught. He was taught the art of craftsmanship by his earthly father. He was taught to be kind to others, probably, by his mother. He was a man. He was a person. He was a human being. He wasn't fallen like we are. He wasn't sinful like we are. But he was every bit as delicate as we are. And Jesus shows us what true human potential really is. So yes, remembering Christ at Christmas is uber important. And we should not let Santa Claus be a replacement for that. But the true Santa Claus is a supplement to that. It is a... It helps us to keep an emphasis. And the way to bring that back is by bringing the Christianity back to the character. Not by dismissing the character as just some secular, commercialized thing that we don't need to have anything to do with. Tell your children who Saint Nicholas was. Tell them that he was a rich man who chose to give all of his wealth away to the poor and the needy. And that the time that he dropped 3 purses of gold to pay for the dowries of three poor girls so that they could be married and they wouldn't have to end up in prostitution. Tell them those stories. And don't forget to tell them about the epic time that he slapped a heretic at an ecumenical council. Santa Claus is a Christian figure. So put the Christian back into the figure. The only reason he was removed was because anti-Catholics tried to distance the character from the church. Don't let that be you. Put the church back in the character. Saint Nicholas was a bishop. He was a bishop of the Catholic Church. He was real, and he did a lot of good things, a lot of great things that the legends of the fictional legendary character come from. His giving away to the poor and the needy, that mixed with Jesus being given gifts at the Nativity, those are where the traditions of gift giving at Christmas time come from. So make sure you're telling your children those stories. And Santa Claus can absolutely be a part of them. Santa Claus and Jesus do not have to be mutually exclusive concepts. In fact, I'm going to let Santa Claus explain the connection for you himself.
Now, you know, everybody's always asking, how is it that Santa Claus ties into the story of Christmas, Christmas being the day that we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ? Well, I can tell you from one standpoint, Santa Claus, in my attire even, is a living testimony to the story of the salvation of God through his love. I mean, I have this green wreath up here on my hat, which when we were born, we came upon this green earth we live upon. We were innocent and pure, much like the white and the snow. However, as we grew, we became older. We learned evil, we descended to sin, and our souls became black. But the great news of all is through grace, through the love of Jesus Christ, and through the red, precious blood of our Lord, he washed our sins away, left our souls as white as snow again. So therefore, when the time comes, we will be able to walk upon the streets of gold. And that is just one of the ways that Santa Claus ties in to the story of Jesus.
So everybody, that's all I have for you today. Thank you very much for joining me. If you like this video, please share it with your friends, share it in your social media groups. If you're not already subscribed to my channel, please hit the subscribe button. Make sweet, sweet love to the notification bell. Thank you everybody for joining me. Go in peace and have a nice day.
My wish is for everybody to have a very blessed Christmas. God bless you all.